In this episode, I'm going to talk about the origin of our origin stories, because one thing that myth presents to us are a variety of questions, and one of those is about our origins and the origins of the cosmos. And this is a distinctive feature of myth. Now, I'm going to examine the myths from Eurasia, that means the lore from Ireland to Japan, without regard, say, to the political boundaries that separate Europe and Asia. And I'm going to talk about specific traditions in this. But to begin with, I want to talk about generally the whole species and why we have myths at all. And I think that one of the more important features that we have to acknowledge here is that myth is a kind of social glue. We will have an episode in which I talk about the sharing of ideas and sharing of aspirations characterized through myth and through community. But right now, I just want to talk about us as a species. And I would think that the most plausible explanation for myth is that it was the earliest form of entertainment. We'll get there. It's not quite there yet. That's stories. And I think that sitting around the campfire after the hunt or after gathering up the crop or whatever you were eating that night, having filled your tummies, you had a little bit of time before you had to go and bunk down in the cave. And I think the only thing that whiled away those periods of time was storytelling about that day or something else that fabulous that happened to someone you knew in the next tribe, that kind of thing. As these features of social interaction, social glue, are emerging with our species, so was language. And I think the evolution and emergence of language somehow paralleled in step the emergence of the use of language to tell these stories and to keep us together as a coherent band and a functioning community of some sort and ensure to maximize the survival of its members. So I would say that in some way the origins of tale-telling is as old as our own origins, as old as the origin of language itself. And language, of course, is one of the mediums in which one speaks about or one conveys information about traditions, about the community, about its habits and beliefs. Ritual, art, these are others as well. But I'm going to talk about language and myth and our cohesion as a society. Now, let's go back to that campfire. Some great tale about the fish that got away or some kind of great big saber-toothed tiger or something like this that one managed to escape and survive and well, how did I get this wonderful antelope that we're now gnawing down on? These sorts of things. Next week is going to be some other story. But maybe if some of these stories were big enough and surprising enough that maybe they lasted a year or two, maybe they lasted 10 years, maybe they lasted 100 years. And as time went by, there would be new tales. Some of the best of the old tales would still be told. I remember when great-grandpa ran across the thunder god, and it was a terrible thunderstorm, and he saw the face of the thunder god himself, you know, that sort of thing. And we were imagining the world this way. And I think that these pile up. They accumulated like strata in geology in some sense. And there are dimensions of modern linguistic theory that suggest that this kind of piling up, this kind of layering effect, is even true of language, even true of the rules that may characterize a particular language. Some seem to be deeper and older than others, and some seem to be shallower. And similarly with storytelling. Some were new, some had to do with the recent hunt, some had to do with things that were so remote that no one could really say who told those stories, where they came from, or when. But they were still there because they were great stories and they were the essential entertainment for the evening and something that the community needed. This was an important, vital function, as important as our very survival. So in a sense, the oldest part of lore that any society, any community will be somewhat garbled. It may be devoid of particular identifiable people or lineages or clans. It will be, in effect, something that looks like what we would call myth. And myth has a number of peculiar characteristics. It is typically inconsistent. It is often garbled. It has sometimes very old words. So the language that was used sometimes itself is preserved and becomes old just as the stories become old. Every society should have this because every society goes through time and piles stuff up as part of its traditions. And one can argue, and I think coherently so, that the oldest layer will be that that looks like myth, and it's going to present certain difficulties in, from our perspective, in modern perspective, of analyzing it and interpreting it as we look at it from what we would call a scientific viewpoint. Okay, this business of being old, of being ancient, carries with it a kind of built-in reverence, just as the elderly seem to be, in many societies, sort of revered for all their knowledge and wisdom, say, so too the older stories were could pick up on that reverence for age, and they were somehow recognized, I think, as being old, simply by contrast with the newer tales, which were more coherent and attributable to actual hunters and people that the tribe might have known in some way. I think that the ancient quality, the enigmatic quality itself became hallmarks, not impediments of understanding. They didn't understand. They simply wanted to repeat them. They became sacred. They became important. Well, so-and-so, my grandfather once told me blah, blah, and you, grandson, your great-great-grandfather, you had better learn this as well. You, granddaughter, you had better learn this as well. And I believe that this reverence for the aging process, for the old dimensions of lore and of the heritage of the community, was crucial also to the very emergence of culture. Culture produces a system of retained knowledge in some way that can be used to help a community or a species, an entire species, survive changes in circumstances without necessarily suffering enormous biological loss. It's a way for a community to shift and evolve without doing so by loss and death of its members. It's a kind of Lamarckian evolution, if you'd like, rather than the Darwinian one. And what one has, in effect, is a kind of tug of war between innovations. So, I mean, if culture can't accommodate new things, well, it becomes rigid, just as though it were a biological system. But if culture can't pass on knowledge that's useful and vital, then what good is it? One might as well wander into the future and all its hazards and vagaries with nothing to rely on except your genes and your swiftness and muscles and so forth. So it is inherent in the very nature of culture, any species carrying culture, that it will always exist in a tension between innovation and conservation. We see this in our politics. This is unavoidable. It will never resolve. It is an essential tension that arises from bearing culture. And in fact, since myth is part of the foundation of culture, we're going to see this between the ancient aspects of the lore and the newer aspects of the lore. And that allows us to define one pole, and the old pole is going to be the mythology. Okay. Now, we must have evolved mechanisms for remembering those stories, for imagining those stories, for finding them to be fun, and to find in them sort of guidance for our lives, maybe because it is part of the culture that's going to help us adapt to circumstances that we cannot foresee. And it relies on the idea that maybe what our ancestors encountered and survived might be useful for us too. So there's something about our way we think about stories that must have evolved as well to give our brains and our minds a natural mechanism for processing these stories, for retaining these stories, and for passing these stories on. And I think one word that we can use to describe that kind of machinery would be archetypes. I think that these were stumbled on by the psychological community and in the course of the 20th century as it began to explore the nature of the human mind. And of course, if archetypes are in the human mind and are vital to its structure, well, lo and behold, the good psychologists like Carl Jung, they discovered these things. They uncovered these things. Now, you can make an inventory of them, and you can go down to the level of some details, and we would call those motifs, maybe some of the peculiar features that typify certain sorts of areas and cultural zones. And we see commonalities, perhaps. The folklorists sort of zero in on motifs, the psychologists zero in on archetypes. There's a difference of detail. But essentially what I would emphasize is that these are the landing strips for the airplanes, so to speak, of story. These are the receptacles. These are the tools we use to basically provide meaning to the lore that has been passed down to us. And unlike, say, the meanings for a word or a verb or some sort of noun or something from a language used for some very specific limited action or object, the life gives us big scenes, big scenarios, big events, and we try to provide meaning. We can't do it by the normal semantic machinery we see in language, but we have to come up with some other mechanism, and archetypes do that. What archetypes do is give us meaning to the tales that we find meaningful. It's a circular argument. It's very hard to give any kind of mathematical proof that archetypes are there, but if one adopts that idea, one has a kind of very good fit between that concept and what we seem to see both in psychology and in the nature of myth. And I think that the archetypes themselves are old. They're as old as the species. There may be some layering effects there. There may be some that are older than others. But in effect, we have a kind of foundational way of thinking. And myth utilizes that foundational way. And later forms, sort of the rationality of which we're so proud now, and perhaps later artistic styles of storytelling, relying on literacy and these other mechanisms, render this older form of thinking profound and enigmatic. And by profound, I mean that they're not subject to conscious reflection. They're built in, they're automatic in a way. And they're sort of like reflexes in the comprehension area of the brain. They are things that seem strange, perhaps, and archaic, and strange because they are archaic. They represent older patterns of relating information and relating events and seeing people and things, and they must have been very sensible and adaptive at one time, but now, in fact, at times seem very strange. They're still there, though. They're still built in, and of course, as we evolve and emerge, there's lots of stuff we still carry with us, including our appendix and some other odds and ends. And I would say that we have a repertoire like this built into our mind in some way. Similarly, arguments in linguistics argue for built-in linguistic capacities that have evolved, and that language itself in some way has very deep and sort of built-in roots into the modern nature of the human mind. Okay. If we look at some of these and we assume generally they're universal, there are studies now that try to examine these in a much broader sense. Some Russian scholars are doing this kind of work. Beryozin from St. Petersburg is one of these. We find some things. Let's just take one kind of, it's not clear whether it's a motif or an archetype, but let's take the number three. This is a very famous folklore number. Three of this and three of that, so forth. Curiously, if one does a little bit of math, for example, you need 3 points to make a curve. Well, that may be something you picked up in high school algebra, something like this. But it suggests, perhaps, that even in making sense of the world, you have to have three events or three people or three something also to make sense of a world and to establish a pattern in some way. And this seems to be, was viewed as a universal feature of myth or folklore. But it's now found that if you go to the lore of the New World with the First Nation or Native peoples of North America, South America, that the number is two. It's not three. And, well, maybe there's a bit of a divergence there in inheritance, and maybe we are able somehow to pinpoint a period in our history, because those people are assumed to have come over, by, say, 15,000, 20,000 years ago. Maybe we can even pinpoint a time in the evolution of our species when some of these numbers or some of these archetypes came to be built in some way, and there may be a slight degree of divergence. doesn't mean we're not all alike in some way and we don't have a lot to share, certainly do, but it also means that we shouldn't expect everything to be exactly the same, that it's richer than we think. And it means also that there's probably lots of work to do and lots of discoveries to be made examining some of these very basic and fundamental ideas that seem to underlie the oldest layer of lore, which we're calling myth. So myth is not something ancient, ossified, frozen, something in a museum case. It's a living, vibrant, strange domain of human perception and human action, human interaction, that it really, really needs new, intensive, and extensive examination. There's lots of new ideas and things that we can uncover and find by examining myth. It suggests various patterns of ancient history, ancient community, and linkages, cultural and economic linkages. And one of the ones I'd like to zero in on now in Eurasian lore is that of the Indo-Europeans. This is technically a linguistic term that began in the early 19th century when scholars came upon the realization that the languages Latin, Greek, and Sanskrit from ancient India, in fact, could be shown to come from an original mother language. This was William Jones's talk addressed to the Royal Asiatic Society in 1776. He was a British bureaucrat and businessman who, typically of the age, had learned Latin and Greek, but when he went to India to govern, had time on his hands and actually learned Sanskrit as well. And the linkages of history between Latin and Greek were too obvious, and people had not paid any attention to the similarities of language. But there were no linkages between the classical period of Rome and Greece and that of ancient India, of classical India. And the similarities between the Indic language and the European languages were so detailed and so extensive that some explanation had to be offered for that those sets of similarities. They were similar in sounds to some extent, but correlations could be found. They were similar in grammar, in the noun, in the verb, and so forth. Now, it turned out that this kind of detail, nitpicking, tedious sort of work, which characterized historical linguistics, quickly bore fruit, and it told us that, well, not only are Greek, Latin, and ancient Sanskrit descended from some common language, but they are also sisters to the original Celtic language from which Welsh and Irish came, Gaelic, to the Germanic languages, including English, German, Dutch, Scandinavian languages, to Slavic languages from the Balkans up through Poland and Czech Republic and east to Russia, Ukraine, other languages, obscure languages that were no longer spoken, were dug up as archaeological artifacts, and some of these were found as far east as Western China and Xinjiang. Some were found very, very old in stones in what's now Turkey. Others were still alive or coming online, like Armenian. And eventually, a kind of language family emerged. The original thinking was very racist, that these were races of people. But by 1870, this was forgotten. And people realized that what they were looking at were commonalities of community, of culture, of civilization in some way, that there was lots of biological mixing and variations in regional appearances and cultures and whatnot, but that the assimilative language was nevertheless a kind of root proof that these diverse cultures had a kind of common original community somewhere that eventually spread out and through time blended in with other local cultures, but still retained traces of its original unity. Then the question came up, well, are there other features that have survived in these various communities that can be compared in similar ways so that we can retrieve not only the language of this original mother community, but also some other aspects of the community, some other aspects of the culture? And this really began with a professor at Dublin named Kelly in 1840, who came out and articulated this for lore, for the myth. And it became a parallel project in which people started examining not just the languages of all these places, and you know, things like Old Prussian from the Baltics and Lithuanian and Latvian and all, but actually the lore as well. And there were very profound social and political consequences of this, because one came from the 18th century with an aristocratic culture in which the only people that mattered, the only people that had anything called culture, were the people at the court with all their fancy garb and good food and everything else. And all the peasants were just swine. They were just human animals out there with their parasites and their little thatched huts and all that. They didn't count. And all of a sudden, all those people out there in those thatched huts with their chickens and their pigs and so forth, they became the carriers of the ancient heritage. They carried the language. They carried the folklore. And these were no longer simply human garbage to be ignored. These were the heart and core of the community. They were the heirs to the ancient heritage. And suddenly you had the Romantic movement. People went out and started collecting folklore and writing down epics. And you had major political upheaval. And in fact, in some ways, the very birth of modern democratic movement, the striving for equality, for dignity in the public sphere and all this, it can go back to some of these ideas. These were the social, these were not neutral ideas, these were powerful ideas that had major impact upon the history of the 19th century and the 20th century. One of the ugliest episodes was a racist episode linked to the Nazis, the rise of the Nazi party under Hitler, particularly in Germany, but also Franco in Spain, Mussolini in Italy, which was a kind of throwback to a simplistic interpretation of all this variety as being racially based. And no scholar of any repute had embraced any of this since 1870. Here we're in 1932 or so with Hitler, and so 60 some odd years later. Behind the times, the Nazis brought great disrepute to the entire effort of historical linguistics and comparative mythology. And it's taken now probably another 60 years, up to the 90s, where scholars such as Georges de Mézil and myself and some other other workers, Dean Miller, University of Rochester, where our efforts are now seen not as racist, not as fascist efforts, but as efforts to retrieve commonalities of community. And our message is no longer that of the Nazis, that there's a super race and the other races don't matter and we're all racist this way and that way. No, our message now is one of deep heritage, deep commonality, and our efforts to retrieve the details of ancient stories, ancient belief systems, ancient languages are not going to set us apart. They're going to unite us in some kind of very deep sense of identity that has been lost in the historical record, and is not particularly taught by your history department anywhere, but will be taught by your mythologist and your comparative linguist. So we have a new message, and I think the new message is a good one and an important one for the time. So when we reconstruct Indo-European, as I began to do, I began to dabble. It's a well-established field. I was trained in it a bit, sort of plundered that field personally with my own career. I also worked on another group of languages. This is not the only language family in Eurasia. We have Chinese and perhaps related to a small set of languages along the Yenisei River. Ket is the only surviving one, perhaps with a linkage to the Diné languages of Alaska and the Canadian Northwest. We have some language isolates like Japanese and Korean. There's been recently found buried in a text a few lines from an unknown language that is obviously related to Japanese, but is not Japanese. So, well, you know, something on the mainland, and obviously the Japanese must have come from there, and so on, because there were originally in Japan Ainu people, different people. They're still there. And we have other families. We have Turkic languages, like the languages of Uzbekistan and Kazakhstan, whatnot, and Turkey. There are families of languages in Siberia. We go south into Southeast Asia, and there are other families. Now, if we can reconstruct one, and we find these others, what do we think? Well, back maybe in 1930s, 1940s, they were aware of this. They were long aware of the Finnic languages, Finnish, Estonian, Hungarian, and others like Mordvin and so. And they were long aware of the Semitic family, Arabic and Hebrew and Akkadian, and more remotely Egyptian and some of the other languages, Berber languages of North Africa and some of the ones of the Southern Sahara, Ethiopian highlands. So people knew that there were various language families. The initial thinking was racist, and that was fed into the Nazis, again, 60 years late. But now we think if we can do one, what we're looking at when we see the others are simply sisters, or now maybe we want to call them cousins, of a more remote grandmother or a great-grandmother. And, well, maybe it's too far back for us to find any really usable similarities or correlations. They don't have to be similar sometimes. As long as you can make up a correlation that's consistent with several words, you can make a case that they go back to an original. So now the idea that these are not in any way related, that they're different, whole different races and whatnot, this just doesn't work anymore. And it's not plausible. If we can do one, there's no reason why we couldn't assume the others go back. We just can't get there. This is too far back by our methods. And we had to fall back on other things, to archaeology and whatnot, to find and trace older cultural bonds, cultural ties, cultural exchanges of various sorts. Now, one of the more interesting places, which we'll talk about in another episode, is the Caucasus. A small region you may have seen when you watch the Olympics being held at Sochi, all those beautiful mountains in the background, those are the mountains of the Caucasus, traditionally ascribed to be, said to be in Europe, and to have the highest mountains in Europe. Mount Elbrus is the highest one. And here, in an area the size of Spain, we have 50 languages with people all more or less sharing common culture and all, but still speaking distinct languages. And the languages themselves seem to go back to three entirely different families. So why three families in such a tiny area? Well, of course, we go to North America, South America, we see similar concentrations in certain areas, like California had an enormous number of languages and 8 or 9 families. Australia, similarly, so on. So what we think we're looking at here is sort of what it might have been like early on, that there were little pockets here and there that people were doing their, pursuing their lives and their livelihood, surviving, carrying on, in small pockets and small communities, without very elaborate means for intercommunication, and that as the centuries rolled by, differentiated, and to such an extent that now we look at them and we see language families and distinct languages. So in the Caucasus, we have three families. Georgian belongs to one. Chechen in the east belongs to something else. These are people now perhaps familiar to you from the various wars in the area in the last 20 years, 25 years. And then Circassians and Abkhazians up in another area. They are largely now live in Turkey and Jordan, with a few here in California. And the diversity, we think, is normal. We see it perhaps from the perspective of the great Indo-European family or, say, a Chinese family, whatnot, as peculiar. But the archaeology suggests that this is how humans were. And what we have now is a history of expansion. And let's go back to the Indo-Europeans in particular. They seem to run from Ireland or still in Ireland, out to originally some languages in Western China. Tocharian was discovered in 1910, I believe, consisting of dusty old parchment in a cave covered in writings about Buddhism. And it's an Indo-European language, now extinct. Why this huge extent? Although they are diverse, surely we can recognize them. Why so far apart? Well, if we go back to the archaeologists and do some interdisciplinary work, it seems that this group, and the best guess now genetically, and I argued linguistically in some papers, was that they came from the North Caucasus or someplace very close to it. They were the first to come up with horse nomadism. And they expanded out on their horses with a facility and speed that no one else could match. And they expanded westward and eastward, and even southerly, down into places like India and Iran, and at one point there were even some in the Middle East that then absorbed, maybe even some entered Egypt at one point. The Hyksos of ancient Egypt were considered intruders from the east and north. So they expanded, and as they did so, they differentiated, they lost contact, the original common community began to differentiate into local communities, and each local community blended in and mixed with predecessors that occupied that territory. And in each branch, each bubble of Indo-European, whether we call it Germanic or Celtic or, say, Iranian or Slavic, we find peculiar words that are confined to that bubble, so to speak, that branch of Indo-European, that characterize that, but in effect are clearly not Indo-European words. They're clearly foreign words. So the older languages are still there in some way. They're buried, and with skill, the linguists can pry them out and identify them. Some of my colleagues spend their entire careers doing nothing but that. And in fact, they suggest at times a kind of coherent linguistic pattern. We can even get a kind of vague idea what the previous language might have looked like. Indo-European itself seems to have been distorted to some extent in each case by some kind of intermarriages and so forth, in which the Indo-European came out sort of blended between mother and father in some way. So this seems like a natural process. We see some of this going on with certain languages today, where one tribe has to take a wife, say, or a husband from a different tribe, so the child grows up with mother and father speaking different languages. Almost always they speak the mother's language and pick up a bit of the father's. So that's sort of what Indo-European looks like. Rather than being wild, crazy warriors, perhaps they were nomads for sure, bringing their cattle and horses, the women may have had a very vital role in the spread of the language. And that's what we see when we do look at these mixed language families. So what were they encountering? They were encountering a diverse world from Europe and the islands off the west coast, the UK and Ireland, over to Western China, the great prairies of Central Asia. They were encountering diverse peoples of various sorts. Now, one scholar who was a pioneer in this effort in creating this scenario was Maria Gambutas. And she had marvelous instincts. She helped us identify the archaeology that was the most plausible archaeology of the Indo-Europeans. And it turns out that these are the grave mounds that you may never have seen. They can be seen if you go to Ukraine and southern Russia. They're still out there. I've seen a few out there on the prairies. They are the burial mounds of the graves of apparently of royalty of some sort. And some of the oldest ones go back to about 5,000 years. And the linguistic guess is, guess what? That the Indo-Europeans on linguistic grounds seem to have been a common community about 5,000 years ago. So the archaeology and the languages are lining up on that one. And when you start looking at the myths, the lore, wow, hey, Odin rules over Valhalla. Well, it's a big house, lots of doors, you know, shields for the roof, blah, 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 and all that. But then there's this funny inconsistency. Well, there's a great big tree in the middle of it, and he puts a sword hanging from the big tree. Okay, well, when we dig into those grave mounds, what do we find? We find a chamber inside, and even when the forest is maybe 300 or 400 kilometers away, they've dragged a huge tree trunk there, and they use it to prop up the middle of the grave chamber, and from it hangs a big sword, and sometimes bows and arrows and spears. So in Valhalla, you get some kind of Viking-like image of a nice big house, but you have an older piece. Again, remember the myth stuff is the old, old stuff. And the older piece is an image of the interior of the grave mound. And of course, Valhalla is the hall of the dead. That's what it means, Val. In English, the only word surviving is wall-eyed, as in wall-eyed pike means dead eye. It's for an eye that doesn't work. And wall, not the wall of the room, but the wall for the dead. This is marginalized in English, but still in Norse, it's an active word. And Valhalla was not just a walkway between rooms and in a building, it was the building itself. So it's the building of the dead. And the building of the dead was, of course, the grave mound. So it's been mutated. Now it's a big, fancy Viking castle, as we find it written down. But originally, you can see right there that it's a grave mound. Well, okay, we go to English lore. There's a grave mounds there. We go out to the Far East and Japan, and we find a grave mound. But wait, what's going on here? Japanese is not Indo-European. No, it's not Indo-European, but they have a grave mound. Okay, they've probably at some time thought, well, we have a great chieftain. What are we going to do with him? Well, what are the guys next door doing with theirs? Well, they're building this big pile of rock and dirt and all that and putting them in a chamber and all. Well, that's pretty fancy. Let's do that too. So what we have now is, to some extent, not just common descent, but we have borrowing as well. And I can go back to another element. Let me zero in on another one. So we have grave mounds. Suddenly the grave mounds are popping up all over the stories. And now we know what they mean because Maria Gambutis identified these, picked these out. Let's go to another element, though. And let's go back to Norse for just quickly. And the great thunder god Thor, he has a fight with a giant. And Thor has his hammer and kills a giant. But before he can kill the giant hurls a weapon at Thor. And what's this weapon? It's really weird. It's a whetstone. Now, what's a whetstone? It's a hone. It's something you use to sharpen your sword or whatever. And back in the old days, this was a very valuable thing to have because you're always getting your sword dealt by killing your enemies, right? So the whetstone sticks in his forehead, and it cannot be removed. It ends up being a kind of crescent moon shape stuck on his forehead. Poor guy, huh? Well, then let's go to Ireland and the great hero Cuchulainn, Hound of the Hound, really is what it means, sort of like the hound in Game of Thrones. And what does he have? He has a Luan Leich. A Luan Leich in Gaelic, it's warrior's moon. Where is it? It's on his forehead. Go to the Caucasus. And here, non-Indo-European again, there's a figure that has a warrior's mark on its forehead. Go to Outer Mongolia. Well, there, it's not easy to get there, but I have a colleague, David Cortum from Vanderbilt, who goes out there routinely and looks at the petroglyphs. What does he see? He sees pictures of riders on, carved into the wall of the cliff. What's above the head of each rider? A crescent moon. Wow, weird. Let's go back to Japan. Let's go to the samurai, samurai warrior. Oh, well, you all know, a very fancy tradition, very, very dramatic, very impressive. Look at the helmet. What's on the front of the helmet? Crescent moon, a warrior's moon. Well, if we go back to the Caucasus, there might be a reason for it. There's a lady who has a shining elbow, and she puts her arm out the castle and illuminates a bridge so her warrior husband can ride over the bridge and find his way out on raids at night. And the elbow, what's a glowing elbow? Best example would be a crescent moon. And she withholds the light because they have a domestic quarrel, and he tries to get back, and he falls off the bridge and dies, and she feels bad about it and all this. So it's a sort of domestic drama. But the crucial thing is that there you have a natural explanation for what became a symbol that spread from one end of Eurasia, Ireland, all the way to the other, Japan. It transcended language barriers. It was a great idea. They liked it. It spread. It was cool. Why? Because our ancestors were as obsessed with looking good and making a good impression as we are. Hey, not that different, right? And so great-grandfather, great-grandmother, you know, multiply that by 20 or so, and you still got people that are recognizable trying to do their best to look like good, impressive people in this life. And here we can make sense of these things now. And before that, I mean, I can't tell you how many times I watched samurai movies when I was in grad school and I was so sick of studying. And I just said, oh, I'm going to watch this beautiful Japanese movie. And here they are, and they got their crescent moon and all that. And then they can think about it. And what's interesting here is when you start looking at myth systematically this way, suddenly things that you've seen, perhaps, you know, how many movies you read about and how many books and whatnot, they're no longer isolated. They're no longer just a little detail. They're a profound link because you're seeing back in time. And they're a link that takes you back to some kind of common process, either common community or some kind of shared sense of, well, hey, you guys, I like your thing. Oh, here, I'll show you my helmet, and you give me a couple of sheep or something. I'm hungry. It shows shared community transcending linguistic lines, and in fact showing a kind of common humanity and a common history of some sort. And the Japanese are stuck on an island. They must have been inland at one time. They must have been in touch with the Indo-Europeans and came away with the crescent moon, came away with the grave mound. Now, what happened to the grave mound in China? And you get them in India, but what happened in China? The grave mound started having little houses on top with a little statue of who was inside. Oh, okay, we get that. It's very nice. It's called the Baobao stone in Turkic, in Siberia and Central Asia. And they eventually became just little statues like gravestones. But further east, they started building house upon house. The grave mound got a little smaller. What did you get in the end? You got a pagoda. And pagoda began as a grave mound. And we can trace that, at least the historians can do that, in the history of architecture in China. And then, of course, it jumped over to Japan as well. So suddenly we see this. It's not just a pagoda anymore. It's, again, another cultural link that has transcended linguistic boundaries. And, in fact, probably did so as a result of people who grew up with a mother that spoke Indo-European or something, or Chinese, or Proto-Chinese, and a father that spoke whatever else. And so when we come to the Caucasus with its three language families, we find, in fact, that the ones that were north have a lot of stuff very, very similar to what we see in the Indo-European traditions. Why? Because they must have been interacting with them in some way, sharing things with them, and sharing stories, sharing symbols, and sharing grave mounds and ways of burying their dead. And this is normal. This is the human norm. This, everything we know, everything we've learned in the last 100 years from looking at this stuff says that the racist theories are wrong, that this is not, this is not a useful way to look. People looked a little different here and there. I mean, it's a matter that how genes sort of link to geography in a way. It can't be avoided. It happens with all animals. But in effect, it's not really relevant. We see all this other material that tells us about our common history, our common shared heritage. And this is the message now of comparative mythology.